the Lord. Higher level people, I said, praise the Lord. Send me. The Lord has sent us already. We are going to succeed. Let's rise up as we pray together. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. Thank you for all these great, great messages you are sending to us. From the preachers and the singers, you are telling us you want to do something new. And you will do it in every life in Jesus' name. We're asking, oh Lord, you send us. And everywhere you send us, we're going to succeed in Jesus' name. Your anointing, your power, your unction, your provision, your prophecy, your promises, everything, all these things are by us. And they're supporting us. And we're going to succeed in Jesus' name. Open our eyes to see, Lord, what we need to see. And to be able to do what you want us to do so that nothing will hinder the progress of the gospel through your people in Jesus' name. Thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you very much. We can sit down. We're coming to an important subject. It's becoming very important now in different parts of the world. And we who are in Deeper Life Bible Church, we seem to have forgotten our own roots and where we started and when we started. We're looking at reproduction of New Testament house churches. The reproduction of New Testament house churches. Some years ago, a church in China faced great persecution. And the state apparatus and the government came against the church very seriously. There's persecution you've heard of people like, I don't want to mention the names, but they're there in history. They went into the prison and they just scattered the whole church. And the people in China thought by a few years' time, the church will be no more. It was then that the people got back to the Bible and they began to see what the Lord can do. And they have this underground church and they meet in houses and they meet in different places because they will not give them land, did not allow them to build any church building, and yet the church kept on growing and increasing. Eventually, I think right now, it's about the calculation or the investigation or research. It varies from person to person. Some people say you have 70 million believers right now there. Other people say 100 million believers, real believers. When they started persecuting them, I think they were just about 5 million to 10 million. But now they have multiplied. And it's because of these house churches. And it's been like that in different places too. I've read of different continents where the church is being persecuted. In some lands where you have the other religion prevailing. And the house churches have really thrived. And as I read all those materials, I then thought about our own church here, Deeper Life Bible Church. We started in a house. It was a house church, a house ministry. And of course, the articles we sent out, Deeper Life articles, we sent it out from that house. And the first tapes were sent out. The tape ministry started in that house. And the Bible study, the Monday Bible study, which has been the backbone of this Deeper Life Bible Church, we started in that house. From 1973 to 1976, 3 years, were just like a house ministry, a house church. And yet, we're growing. Growing into thousands and thousands before we actually let plateau that house church or house ministry. And then our people began to go to different places. One of our brothers went to Benin and started there. And another brother went to Akure, started there. Another brother went to Enugu, started there. And you know, the church just began to grow. And I was just checking up now from our brother just preached on self-denial and cross-bearing. He was actually in Onitsha. And he heard about this Bible study. And we need a Bible study at Onitsha. It was in Benin. And he will travel every week to the Bible study over there. And so that we didn't have church buildings at that time, or property, or landed property, did not hinder us at all. We kept on moving and moving and moving. And those of us who are meanwhile from Ghana, you remember where we started. And those who are from Sierra Leone, you are here, you remember where we started. And from place to place, this is how we began. But today, there are many people that are thinking, because they won't give us land, and we don't have this, we don't have that, therefore the church cannot grow. That's why we're looking at the New Testament again, to see what kind of possibilities we have when we see that the house churches. I'm looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, reading from verse 19. The churches of Asia salute you. Aquila and Priscilla salute you. Much in the Lord with the church in their house. With the church in their house. Because the church was in the house, that did not limit the power of the church in that house. Did not limit the possibilities of the church in that house. And so, in the places where we are, no landed property yet, and there is no building yet, there's no church building yet, we can start where we are. Church in the house. Colossians chapter 4, we're looking at verse 15. Out of the mouths of two or three witnesses, the truth shall be established. We're looking in at Colossians chapter 4, verse 15. Salute the brethren which are in Laodicea and Nymphas, and the church which is in his house. Here we find another believer that surrendered his house. Because you think about it from Acts chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, all through to the end of the Acts of the Apostles, there was persecution everywhere. Who will give land to any church at that time? Who will allow them to have building permit at that time? Who will allow them to be the cathedral or a great church building at that time? But even though they will not give them land, or don't allow them to build any edifice, yet the church kept on growing. They filled Jerusalem with the doctrine without having any church building, and they filled all those places of Asia Minor with their doctrine without any church building. And we can still do the same today, that we go from place to place and plant churches and raise up believers and disciple them even without any landed property. You've seen it in 1 Corinthians, you've seen it in Colossians. Let's look at Philemon. I'm looking at Philemon verses 1 and 2. Philemon verses 1 and 2, it says, Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy, our brother, unto Philemon, our dearly beloved and fellow laborer, and to our beloved Apphia, and Archippus, and our fellow soldier, and the church in thy house, and the church in thy house. You thought it was only Aquila and Priscilla that had church in the house? No, quite a number of them had church in the house. And that's why we're coming to talk to ourselves today. Of course, when you have land, you should have church building. When you have the money, you should have church building. It may be in a village, it may be in a local government, in a city or in a town, and you're giving land, you ought to have good church building. We're mega cities, and in those mega cities, we're able to have land, we're able to build. But when you have restriction, you don't have the money, maybe even the land is available, but there's no money to build a church, a church building. You should be able to say, well, there are house churches. And then you go to actually practice, watch their practice now in China and different parts of the world. We're looking at this under three perspectives. Number one, exemplary church model in the house. Exemplary church model in the house. Number two, extensive church ministry in the house. That even though there was no church building yet, extensive church ministry. Ministry going on, ministry of teaching, of preaching, of healing, of deliverance, of evangelism, of discipling people, edifying them, building them up to bring them to maturity. Extensive church ministry in the house. And then you have number three, exponential church multiplication in houses. Exponential church multiplication in houses. Now let's come to number one. Give me number one. Exemplary church model in the house. We're looking at Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. as we look at this, remember these are the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I say unto, also unto thee, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Can I remind you that when Jesus said that, he didn't even have a personal accommodation where he would lay his head. He said, the foxes have holes, and the birds of the air, they have nest, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. You understand that at this time when Jesus said, I will build my church, the church that is the Lord Jesus and his disciples, they didn't have any parcel of land, no piece of land, no property at all that they could refer to as their own. And yet he said, in spite of that, even though there are no properties, even though there's no land, even though there's no church building, they didn't have any synagogue of their own. They didn't have any sanctuary of their own. They didn't have any temple of their own. That's why you're going to find out that where Jesus went, he went to the synagogue. They belong to him. They belong to the disciples. It belonged to the Pharisees and Sadducees that were opposing him. And you come to the Acts of the Apostles, and Paul went to the synagogue. Why? Because the church did not have any church building of their own. And therefore they used all those borrowed buildings. And of course they used their houses. Look at Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18, I'm reading from verse 15 here. Jesus Christ speaking about the church. The church can exist where there's no building. The church can exist where there's no physical temple. The church was there, and yet there was no building. Don't you ever think, because we don't have any church building here, we're in this city, and you know, people are writing to us, we're in Malaysia, we're in Mauritius, we're in Mauritania, we're in this other place, and there is no money to build a church. And we have some numbers of us here, and some we have discovered, we have a deeper life member there, deeper life member there, we're about 15, we're about 20, but because we do not have any church building, I was expecting money from the headquarters. Which headquarters I'll spend money from? I'm still going to talk to you about how the other churches, they sent money to Jerusalem. I've not read what Jerusalem was sending money to this place. I'm sending money to Asia, sending money to Philippi, sending money to Corinth, sending money everywhere. We have to follow the Bible. Well, let's come back to what we're talking about. The church was there, but there's no property there yet. Look at chapter 18, verse 15. Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. But if he will not hear thee, it says, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he shall neglect to hear them, tell it to who? To the church. No church building, no apartment, no personal property they can call their own. But the church held on operating. Preaching was going on. Evangelism was going on. The teaching of the word was going on. Counseling was going on. Resolving of conflicts and doubts, all those things were going on. The church was there, but the buildings were not there. The sanctuaries were not there. We should not say because there's no sanctuary we cannot evangelize. We say, after all, if we evangelize, where are we going to take the people? You take them to your house and you have fellowship there. I'm going to show you how all the ministries of the church, all the various things we do in the church, everything, they did it in those houses at that time. I'm looking at chapter 13 of Matthew. Matthew chapter 13, we're looking at it from verse 36. Matthew chapter 13, verse 36. In verse 36, see what it says here. And then Jesus sent the multitude away. Where had they been meeting? Before he sent them away, they were in the open field. In the open field, that's where they met. That's why I told them all those parables, these great things you are reading. All this word of God you are reading about in Matthew, they took place either in the house or in the open field, not in a sanctuary of their own. It says when he sent them away, he went into the house, and his disciples came unto him, saying, declare unto us the parable of the tares of the field. I cannot declare to you, because it's a house. We must find a sanctuary. There's no sanctuary. Find a temple. There's no temple. We'll find a synagogue. There's no synagogue available now. Well then, let's wait until we have a church building, a sanctuary. Then I will tell you the meaning of that parable. No, he started teaching them. It was in else. You saw that in verse 36. Verse 37, he answered and said unto them, he that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed is the children of the, are the children of the kingdom. And it tells that the children of the wicked one, the enemy that sowed them is the devil, and the harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are the angels. Well, he went on to show them what it really meant for them to believe on the Lord, and then for them to be righteous, because the righteous people are those who are going to inherit the kingdom eventually. Verse 40, and therefore therefore the tires are gathered and burnt in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then shall the righteous shine forth, that righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. What was ears to hear, let him hear. All that teaching was given in the house, which means then we can have Bible study in the house. It's not a crime. That's how we started. We have the Bible study in the house. There are some people that are telling us, even a city here at headquarters in Lagos, they're saying that we actually have a converse, some people in this area of Lagos, in that area of Lagos, they want to have the Bible study, and we could actually get this for them, but we could have something that they'll be able to receive the Bible study. But we don't have any church building. I have applied to the vetting committee, and you know, they said that there's an embargo because now the money is not enough to go around. And we're waiting, we're pleading with the pastor, if the pastor will just tell them, lift up the embargo, because in our area, many people want to come. You know that in this place, as we're reading the Bible, many wanted to come to study the Word of God. Disciples that were being raised up, and Jesus did not wait until they had great church buildings. He taught them. We're looking at Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2. We're talking of the Lord of heaven and earth. We're talking of the creator of the whole universe. We're talking about Jesus Christ, the very Son of God. He should have been able to say, whether they like it or not, the land belongs to my Father, and in the Father has sent me, and I'm not going to do anything until the Lord will move in the hearts and the minds of these people, and they give me good land, and they were going to build a great edifice, a great church. I think if Jesus wanted to leave anything behind, it should be like the people are thinking today. We're going to build a mighty church building and leave that behind, and when they are passing by, they will know that belongs to the church, such and such. Jesus did not have that intention. The intention he had was to raise up disciples, members of the church, that will be militant and then take over the world. Not because of money, not because of church buildings. Look at Mark chapter 2, reading from verse 1. And again he entered into Capernaum, and after some days, and it was noise that he was, where was he? In the house. And straightway many were gathered together, in so much that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them in the house. That reminds me when we were in Flatue, 1973. And the sitting room was able to contain us because we were just 15. And then we went to 20 and to 40 and to 50, was still all right. And then we went to 100, was still all right. And then we came to 400, 500, and people will be sitting outside at the back, outside in the front, and all that area for 3 years. And we grew beyond almost 1,000 before we relocated and went to a place in the town. And so, if we did that, you can do the same thing too. Well, it may be that you'll not be able to shout and, you know, have a blaring loudspeaker so that you don't disturb the neighbors who are there, but you can still sing. And in our country here, there are people that throw parties, and when they throw parties, they sing. when they throw parties, they make, you know, real hell of noise, and yet nobody disturbs them. Why is it that we cannot have Bible study and fellowship and worship in our houses? Of course we can. That's what they did over here. And this great miracle that took place, they brought this man that had the palsy, that is, was paralyzed and sick and totally weak. It was there, they removed one of the tiles in the roof, and then Jesus said, your sins are forgiven. They got saved in the house, and then the miracle of healing came upon them. They got healed in the house. We can have salvation in the house, and we can have healing in the house. At least that's what they got there, and I pray that we'll get back to that in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 26, I'm reading from verse 18. Matthew chapter 26, we're looking at verse 18, and he said, go into the city to such a man and say, the master saith, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover where? At thy house with my disciples. The first Lord's Supper was initiated or was done in the house. I will keep the Passover in thy house. What do we do in the church? We sing in the church. Do that in the house. We preach in the church. They do that in the house. We teach in the church. They do that in the house. We answer questions. Question and answer. After study scripture, the disciples came to Jesus in the house. They asked questions. He answered them. The Lord's Supper, to serve that Lord's Supper, it was right there in the house. I'm going to have the Passover in thy house. Look at verse 26. In verse 26, this is what he tells us. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and break it. Remember, this is the house. And gave it to the disciples and said, take it, this is my body. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave each of them, saying, drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the removal and remission of their sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom. These people were ready enough, were already saved, and even though they were meeting in the house, they could prepare for the rapture. And then when I come, I will see you. I will drink it with you. Look at verse 30. And when they had done what? Tell me out loud. Sung an hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. See, congregational song, that's it, took place in the house over there. In each saying, you know, we cannot sing, we cannot worship, we cannot pray, we cannot teach, we cannot evangelize, because there's no church building. The house is good enough for the church building. And so they sang their congregational song, they preached in the house, and they helped people to know the Lord more right there in the house. I'm looking at chapter 2 of Mark. Mark chapter 2. We'll go back there again. Mark chapter 2. We're looking at verse 15. Mark chapter 2, verse 15. And it came to pass, as Jesus sat at meat in his house, many publicans and sinners sat also together with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many, and they followed him. You see that? It was in the house of Matthew that Jesus Christ entered, and many publicans and sinners, they came. That's evangelism right there. That's a kind of evangelistic crusade right there. But you know, we don't have money to hire a stadium. Well, get somebody's house and use the backyard of their house or the front of their house and do that evangelism there, and do and have that evangelistic campaign and have that evangelistic crusade and have the word of salvation, the word of eternal life, and give it out right there in that house, and do all your singing in that house, all the altar call in that house, and all the leading to the Lord, the people of God that become the children of God, lead them right in that house, and then take all their names and put all those cards in there right in that house, or in front of that house, the back of that house. We can do quite a lot with those houses belonging to our members. That means, let's say for example, take Lagos. If we ask our members, how many of you have houses you are living in? And you have all this yard behind there, and you have that yard, and have that yard, and have that yard. might be able to have 1,000, and within 1 month we can have church in 1,000 places. Not that we're still queuing up, we're waiting for money, and the money is not there. I'm telling you, the money is not there. Maybe I need to tell everybody, because you know you are coming from these various countries and you want to apply. This time I come to the headquarters, we're going to have this, we're going to have that. Well, it's not there really. And if I had time, I'll tell you all the analysis of all the finance in the church at headquarters here. That's why maybe I should even take offering before you go. And all your new people just watching all the conferences I attend, when we have a crowd like this, and then all those people, when they invite me to preach, they say, "Pastor, not your turn yet, we'll call you when we're ready." So all these people, they have all the money in their pocket, you'll not allow them to go like that, and you have just been, you know, enjoying, and then you go here, you go there, you see all those buildings there, I think it's time you give an offering. Praise the Lord. Well, you think I'm joking, you'll be surprised. But we thank the Lord for what the Lord is doing, because you know the Lord is telling us that we need to do something. Your houses are there and we're going to use them. I said we're going to use them. All the cities we come from, tell your members, we can have Bible study in their houses. We can have, it's not a private thing, we can even have 100 members in that house there, 1,000 over there, 500 over there, 400 over there, and we're going to plant the churches all the places where we have the houses of the believers in Jesus' name. I'm looking at John chapter 3, and I'm reading there from verse 1. And there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews, and came to Jesus by night. Came to Jesus by night. Although a house is not mentioned here, but we know it's going to be in a house, because Jesus was about to sleep. It was in the night. He had finished all the day's activities. It was in the night. And he had finished everything he should have done for the day. And now Nicodemus came to that house by night and said unto him, "Rabbi, teacher, master, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Now what I'm telling you, the first time the language "born again" was used, it was in a house. Not on a field, not in a cathedral, not in a church building, it was in a house. Nicodemus came to Jesus by night in the house where he was going to sleep, and it was in that house that Jesus Christ mentioned being born again and established the teaching, the doctrine of the indispensability of being born again to get to heaven. Which means then, if we really understand that being born again was first of all mentioned in the house, of course we'll get people born again in the house, sanctified in the house. I want you to come to John chapter 13, chapter 14, chapter 15, chapter 16, chapter 17. They were the private things Jesus did with his own disciples. It wasn't in the public, it wasn't in synagogue, it wasn't in a temple, it wasn't in a sanctuary, public sanctuary, it wasn't on the field, it was with his own disciples. And you will see when you read everything, because this is the time when Judas was there and he said, "One of you will betray me." It was in the house. And you'll see in chapter 13, feet washing that he did there, that was in the house. In chapter 13, when he said, "The greatest commandment, a new commandment I give unto you, love one another as I have loved you," that was in the house. Chapter 14, when he said, "I'm going away and I'm going to come back to take you to myself," talking about the rapture and the second coming, it was in the house. And then in that chapter 14, when he spoke about the works I do, you shall do, the power to work signs and wonders, It was in the house. In this chapter 14, when he spoke about the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth that is with you and will be in you, it was in the house. In chapter 15, when he spoke about this vine, I'm the true vine, and ye are the branches, and my Father is the husbandman, all that is said in the house. In this same chapter 15, he spoke about persecution, and he said, you're going to be persecuted, but you will endure. It was in the house. You come to chapter 16 when he said, I have many things to say to you. I cannot tell you now, but when the Spirit is come, it will teach you all things and guide you into all truth. It was in the house. And the great prayer, the high priestly prayer of sanctification in chapter 17, it was in the house. In the house that he said, Father, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. You understand then, all the major doctrines of the Bible, from repentance to salvation, to being born again, that's the new birth, to being sanctified, all the major doctrines, to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, all the major doctrines, even the Lord's Supper, everything he gave to them in the house church. How then are you going to say that because we don't have a church building, that's why I cannot have church, we'll do this or that? We can do it because the establishment of the house churches will make us to be able to go everywhere. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, I'm reading there from verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled where? Tell me out loud, all the house where they were sitting. The Holy Ghost baptism, the first experience of the outpouring of the Holy Ghost and the fulfillment of the prophecy of Joel happened in the house. Happened in the house. And when you go to Acts of the Apostles chapter 10, when Cornelius and all these people were there in the house and Peter was preaching, the Holy Ghost came upon them in the house. In the house. And when you think about Saul and Paul himself, as Ananias went to him and the Lord said, go see that man, he's on this street, he's in this house. And when Ananias got there, but this man, Paul the Apostle, received the Holy Ghost baptism in the house. Therefore, we understand that as you look at your New Testament, we see the presence of the house churches. And because that is what they did at that time, when you don't have land, and you have members, and you have people that have houses, they give their houses, and then we're able to have church. We'll have church in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen. Point number two now, extensive church ministry, extensive church ministry in the house, extensive church ministry in the house. Some people say, you know, we're limited because we're only meeting in houses. There's nothing like that. I told you of the history of Deeper Life, and I'm sure you know that yourself, that we started in the house. And when we said we're not limited, men came, women came, they parked their cars, you know, on the road, on the street, and then highly placed people came, and people from all sections of society, they came to the Bible study because they knew that something good is going on there. Now, have you noticed that, you know, the people, somebody becomes a medical doctor, and then he wants to establish a clinic, an hospital, and he's not waiting for a great building in the house where he is. You have something there, and then he puts the signboard there. There's a doctor there, there's a clinic there, and people have been healed there. If medical doctors are doing it, why are you not doing it for the church? And then somebody wants to establish an educational system. Think about this, that somebody says, I've trained myself, I'm an educationist, and I want to establish a primary school or a secondary school. And in the house where they are, they establish the secondary school or the primary school right there. And they keep on expanding in a rented apartment before they even have a house or a building of their own. If they're doing it in education, why can't you do it? Somebody is into electronics and he says, I want to do this, I want to set up this kind of business. And then the house where he's living, he has something there, and eventually the thing is expanding until they're able to get money to have land. And a person is going to sell spare parts, you know, use spare parts sellers who are here. And where do you start? There is a shop in your house right there. And you start in a small way like that, and before you know what, that's an extensive thing that we're doing. There is nothing you want to do that you are not starting in a house. And the same thing with the church. We start where we are, and we're going to have extensive ministry through that house in Jesus' name. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. Acts of the Apostles chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 41. And they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about how many souls? About 3,000 souls. And it says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship. They didn't have a church building. You know, when Jesus left them, they were even hiding themselves, because they thought the Pharisees would be after them. Of course they were after them. And yet, when those 3,000 people became born again, they didn't say, this is what we're saying, now where are they going to meet? This is what we're saying, where are we going to put all these people? The Holy Ghost had come, great manifestation of power had been demonstrated, and these 3,000 came to know the Lord as their personal Savior. And now we need to disciple them and train them and bring them up and mature and equip them to be able to go and tell other people too. And those 3,000 people continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. Remember, the Holy Ghost came upon them, were read it already in the first part of the chapter of chapter 2, in the house. It was a church building, and yet they were able to follow those people up. 3,000 converts. Look at verse 46. It says in verse 46, and they continuing daily with one accord in the temple. That didn't belong to them. That's a borrowed apartment, a borrowed temple. And breaking bread from, tell me out loud, house to, what does that mean? Think about 3,000 people. 3,000 people. How are we going to take care of these people? 3,000 people. All right, this is how we're going to do it. 100, you'll be fellowshipping here. Where did you come from? We come from Day Street. Okay, there's a house there, 100. You're worshipping there. And by the time you have 100 here, 100 here, 100 here, 30 houses. And when you distribute them like that, that's why now we need to serve the Lord's Supper. And they went from house to house. 100 here we serve them, 100 there we serve them, 100 there we serve them, and we disciple them all. After all, there were 12 apostles. You take care of that, you take care of that, you take care of that. That's how they distributed themselves to all those houses. That's why it says they went from house to house, and they were eating their meat with singleness of heart and praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church. Was their church? I said, was there a church? Where were they meeting? House to house. And then it says, daily such as should be saved. That extensive work going on, even though they didn't have a building of their own. I'm looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 5 and verse 42. Acts chapter 5 verse 42. And daily in the temple and in every house. And daily in the temple and in every house. Remember, the temple did not belong to them, and that's why they came to arrest them and whisk them into the prison. And then the angel came and said, go back there again and go and teach the people and tell the people this word of life. And it says, and in every house he ceased not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. Well, there are some people that are saying, well, maybe you're talking about Nigeria, of course, yes. Maybe you're talking about Africa, of course, yes. But you know, it cannot happen with us because we're coming from the West. Is that so? It cannot happen. There's something that hinders people come from the West having 5 people. You have house fellowship. That house fellowship can develop to a house church. And you can have 20 people there and 20 people there and 20 people there. And after all, 20 times 100 is, tell me quickly, 20 times 100 is 2,000. And if you have 100 places that is scattered all over that big city there, and you have 20 here, and then you have another 20 here, you have another 20, another 25 there, another 30 there, by the time you add everything together, and then you have pastors over them, that we're meeting them in their houses does not mean that we're not pastors. You know, I'm not a pastor because I have 100 people, but those 100 people, they're not in a church building. It's only when I have a church building, it's sanctuary, then I will know I'm a pastor. Not at all. Peter was an apostle, was meeting them in the house. Paul the apostle was an apostle, was meeting them in the house. That we are meeting them in the house does not take anything away from our office, from our ministry. We're still pastors, and we're still apostles, and we're still whatever God has made us, and the work of God will keep on moving and progressing in our lives in Jesus' name. Look at this, Acts chapter 5 verse 42, and daily in the temple and in every house it ceased not to teach and to preach Jesus Christ. It doesn't limit the kind of doctrine we preach because we're meeting in the house. Acts of the Apostles chapter 9, I read from verse 11. Acts chapter 9, we're looking at verse 11. The greatest apostle of all time was discipled in the house. The greatest apostle of all time received his first miracle, great miracle, his eyes opened, the Holy Ghost coming upon him in a house. Why then do we think we cannot develop workers, mature workers, train the workers, equip the workers, enlist the workers, mobilize the workers in the house? Of course we can. Of course we can. Acts chapter 9 verse 11. And the Lord said unto him, unto Ananias, he said, arise and go into the street, which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayed, the most effective prayer ever prayed in his life, that ushered him into the depths of the grace of God, of the gifts of the Lord. It was in a house. Therefore, don't ever say that, you know, because it's just a house, no church building, no temple, no sanctuary, we cannot do anything. Look at verse 12. And had seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him, and he might receive his sight. That is, Saul had seen a vision. The first vision he ever saw was not in a temple. The first vision he ever saw, it wasn't in a sanctuary. It was in a house. And if the vision can come to him in the house, if the power of the Lord can operate in his life in the house, how about us today? It can happen. It will happen in Jesus' name. That's the reason we're saying that, as we understand that in this generation now, where there are difficulties and you cannot have landed property, maybe you can have, but the money is not there, or you cannot have a sanctuary and it will not give you the permit, we don't need to lose any member of the church. Neither do we need to lose the method of evangelism and the progress of the work to evangelize, because we can use the houses that are available. You can rent a house where you are living, and then you make a part of that house available so that the work of the Lord will go on. It says in verse 13, then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he has done to thy saints at Jerusalem, and here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, where was Ananias at this time when the Lord was talking to him? In his own house. That means then in our houses we can be spiritual. In our houses we can really worship the Lord. In our houses the Lord can meet us and give us deep revelations of his word and reveal his might unto us. And then he sends us to another house to go and operate in the power of the Holy Ghost. Look at verse 15. It says, for the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and the kings and the children of Israel, for I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, has sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately there fell from his eyes as it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith and arose and was baptized. And so you see that happened in the house. We're looking at Acts chapter 10. I'm reading from verse 30. Acts chapter 10 verse 30. as you go through the Acts of the Apostles, you see that what was prevalent there was the house church. What was common then was the house church. What filled the cities were the doctrine, or the teaching, or the believers, or the disciples. What filled everywhere was the knowledge of the Lord. What filled them was the houses, the house churches. Almost in every street you have a house church. Every community a house church. Everywhere a house church. And it's the totality of that that made the large church, the big church we're talking about. And we can say the same thing today. Not just house fellowship, house churches. House churches where people are meeting. And when we don't have the church building, then we can make use of those. We're looking at Acts chapter 10 verse 30. In Acts chapter 10 verse 30, here is what it says. And Cornelius said, 4 days ago, I was fasting until this hour, and at the ninth hour I prayed in my house. I prayed in my house, and behold, a man, actually an angel, stood before me in bright clothing and said, Cornelius, thy prayer is heard, and thine arms are heard, are heard in remembrance in the sight of God. Send therefore to Joppa, and call thither Simon, whose name is Peter, whose surname is Peter. He is lodged in the house of one Simon, a tanner by the sea. Remember, even Peter himself in the house over there, that's what they want to call. He received the call to come and preach the gospel to the Gentiles in a house. And then he says, when he cometh, he shall speak unto thee. Immediately, therefore, I sent to thee, and thou hast well done that thou art come. Now therefore, we are all here present before God to hear all things that are commanded thee of God. We are all here. It was in his house. He brought them to his house. Before Peter came, he had invited all those people, and they were in his house. And it was in that house, as Peter was speaking, look at verse 44. While Peter was yet speak these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them that had the word. And they of the circumcision which believed were surprised, astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that of the Gentiles, on the Gentiles also was poured the gift of the Holy Ghost, for they heard them speak with tongues and mighty and magnify God. Then Peter answered, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And then it says, and he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then prayed they him to tarry certain days. He waited certain days, teaching them and teaching them in the house. Extensive ministry going on, even though it was in the house. We're looking at Acts chapter 12. Acts chapter 12. We're looking at it from verse 5. In verse 5, it says, now Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. Peter was kept in the prison. And as he was in the prison, we had that in the morning, Herod was thinking, lay hands on him. I'll destroy him. I'll kill him. His days are all numbered. He's about to go. And the church was praying for him. Come back to that verse 5 again. Look at it from the middle. It says, but prayer was made without ceasing of who? Of the church unto God for him. The question is, where was the church? Where was the church? Look at it in verse 12. And when he had considered this after the deliverance, this after he was set free, this after the angel came upon him and got him up and got him out of that place, and he considered, where will I go? He went to where they were having prayer, where the church was praying. And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many, not just a few, many were gathered together praying. And so we can see that the extensive work of the Lord was done actually in the houses at that time. Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20, verses 20 and 21. The point is very clear. So come to the Acts of the Apostles. Yes, they even had money because people sold their landed property. And they sold everything they've got. They brought the money to the apostles' feet. But they used to spend the money to take care of the believers. It didn't even occur to them that they had cathedrals and temples and all that. Is it because the Lord has said, see that temple? They spent 46 years. You know, some people tell us that, you know, they won't come to our church because, you know, the Catholic Church has good, great, mighty buildings. And then the Anglican Church, great, mighty cathedrals. And the Methodist Church, great, mighty cathedrals. And the Episcopal Church, great, mighty cathedrals. And so if we don't have a cathedral that will match their own, how do you think they will come? They have the temple in Jerusalem. It took 46 years to build. It was a magnificent thing. And yet, there was no miracle there, no salvation there, no new birth there, no sanctification there, no holiness there, no church there. But the church met in houses. And the people that were being converted, they've been going to those cathedrals before. And those cathedrals took thousands of their currency to build. And yet, they vacated all, they emptied all those things out, and they met in the houses. If we do the same thing today, and we're preaching of the power of the Lord, it doesn't matter where you are, it will come to you. You know that that's the reason why John the Baptist could not, that's why he stayed in the wilderness. He didn't build any church, didn't build any building, but he was in the wilderness. But the power of God was there, and he came out of all the cities, and they went to him where he was. He'll go to you wherever you are. In a house, an apartment, in a field, or wherever, it'll come to you, and they will receive what the Lord has given us and given to you, in particular this time, in Jesus' name. Acts chapter 20, I'm reading from verse 20. Here is Paul talking to the people, how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but I have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house. I've taught you publicly and from house to house. What happened is that when Paul the apostle came to town, when he came to Ephesus, he had all the addresses of the houses where they were using as churches. He had the addresses with him. And he'll go to this address, I've gone there, and then mark this or that, mark all this. So, and he said, I went from house to house teaching them. And all the doctrines were taught, all the doctrines were taught. Not just because they are meeting us, we cannot teach this or teach that. No, it says in verse 21, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, that is the people meeting in those houses, were both Gentiles and Greeks. It says repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. If they did it then, we can do it now. Well, we'll do it now. I said we'll do it now. Acts of the Apostles chapter 28, we're looking at the two verses that end that, the Acts of the Apostles. Acts chapter 28, I'm looking at verses 30 and 31. We're not saying that we cannot have church. Of course, we have church buildings. Where we are now, this is not a house. This is a sanctuary, it's a church building. And yet, that's because we had the opportunity. But in the town, we can have houses. And anytime we have built church buildings too, if in your place, in your city, the money is there, the land, of course you ought to build a good, decent building. In the village, you ought to build a good, decent building. And in the local government, you ought to build good, decent buildings. We are saying, but when before the money comes, and before the land becomes available, that wherever you are, don't say, because we don't have a church building yet, therefore we cannot do the work of God. You can do an extensive ministry for the Lord, even before those church buildings are raised up. We're going to do it in Jesus' name. I told you I'm doing it in China. That's not Africa, and that's a civilized world, and the church is growing by the millions over there. We're looking at Acts chapter 28, verse 30 and verse 31. And Paul dwelt 2 whole years in his own hired house, rented apartment in his own hired house, and received all that came unto him. Great apostle, with great power of the Lord, and with great signs and wonders. He was in a hired house, and then the people that came was receiving them. And when he received them, look at verse 31, preaching the kingdom of God in that hired house, teaching those things in that hired house, which concern the Lord Jesus with all confidence, no man forbidding him. If they did it then, we'll do it again. I come to point number three, is exponential church. Exponential church multiplication in the houses. Exponential church multiplication in houses. Let's look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 9. You see now they operated in the Acts of the Apostles, and the churches multiplied, the churches grew, even though they were meeting in house churches. We're looking at Acts chapter 9, verse 31. Then had the churches rest throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria, and were edified, walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost, were multiplied. They were multiplied. They were in the houses and they were multiplied. No sanctuary, they were multiplied. No temple, they were multiplied. And there was no synagogue of them, they were multiplied. And they were walking in the fear of the Lord. There was holiness, there was righteousness, even though they were just meeting in those houses. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 17. Acts chapter 17, I read to you from verse 1. It says, now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the believers. Are you hearing me? You're not reading your Bible. Look at chapter 17, verse 1. That's how I catch people that are just looking at my face as if the scripture is on my face. Hey, it's in your Bible, it's not on my face. Where is the scripture? Is it on my face? Okay, it's on my dress. Praise the Lord. Look at your Bible. Are you there? Acts chapter 17. Which verse am I reading now? Verse 1, everybody. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the believers. Of who? Of the Jews. It's like when I say, where there was a synagogue of the Anglicans, a synagogue of the Methodists, a synagogue of the Catholics, or here, a synagogue of the Jews. They didn't have a building of their own. And it says, and Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and three Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the scriptures. He went to those synagogues of the Jews. And some people will say, how is it? We'll say we're preaching a salvation, we're preaching a holiness, we're preaching a Holy Ghost baptism, we're preaching healing, and then we don't have a church being of our own and think about it. We have to go to those dead churches, and then we have to say that we're renting their building, we're getting their building, and then think about, you know, our church saying that we have a Catholic church building, and they say you can use it, or we have Episcopal, Methodist, Anglican church building, you can use it. How can it be? If they can have their building, how can't we have our own? Bring out the money and have your own now. But if the money is not there yet, and the synagogue of the Jews that is there, and the synagogue of the Methodists that is there, and the synagogue of the Orthodox Church in the Eastern, in the East that is there, then you make use of what you have, what's available. It says in verse 3, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ. And some of them believed and consulted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks, a great multitude, and of the chief women, not a few. It wasn't their own personal building where that was done. A great, mighty evangelistic work was done, and multitudes came to know the Lord. You know, it mentioned Thessalonica there. Come and look at the church, how strong the church became, even though they didn't have any church building. You know, some people are saying, you know, our churches have been strong because I know my talent, I know my gift. Now, if we had a place of our own, and then all my talent I bring to the people and I teach the people, they'll be steadfast. I know. But because we don't have any building, we're here days and months now. At the end of the month, they say we don't, no chance again there. We have to announce we're now in this other church building. And then after 3 months, they were just going here and there because we don't have a building of our own. If we had a stable place, we can say this is Deeper Life Bible Church, and the people see that signboard and they see the magnificent building. I'm telling you, with all the gifts I have, I will do something. Do something now. You can do it now. I said you can do it now. Look at it in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Look at the church here. No synagogue of their own. Just a synagogue of the Jews that they use. And he went there 3 Sabbath days and he taught the people. He said, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and your labor of love and your patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Knowing, brethren, beloved, your election of God, for our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sakes, and ye became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost. You see, they had the Holy Ghost, they had the joy, they had all that stability and steadfastness, even though there was no church building. They met in the synagogue of the Jews. That's where they received the gospel. Great number received the gospel and see how strong they were. Look at this in verse 7. It says, so that ye were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. For from you sounded out the word of the Lord. Not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to God's word is spread abroad, so that we need not speak anything. For they themselves show us what manner of entering in we urge unto you, how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and the true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. Do you see that? Even though there was no church building, the church was multiplying. The time has come for this church to multiply. Acts chapter 19. I'm reading from verse 8. Acts chapter 19. We're looking at verse 8. It says in verse 8, and he went into the synagogue. You see that? When he got to that place, there was no church building for the believers, for the saints, for those who are born again, for the sanctified. No church building, but they had grace. They had purity. They had the gospel. And the synagogue was there. So he went into the synagogue and he spake boldly by the space of 3 months, disputing and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God. But when divers were hardened and believed not, but spake evil of the way before the multitude, he departed from thence and separated the disciples, disputing daily in, you tell me now, in the school of Paul the Apostle. Tell me, you see that? He didn't have any school, and here he didn't have a house he could go to, and somebody had a school. He said, if they're driving you from there, come and use my school here. And some people are telling us, you know, if we're the building, if it's not because we're using primary school and we're using primary school desks and benches, why don't you buy your own chairs and take your chairs to that school, and the space is there and the rooms are there, and if you know that the chairs of those children will not suit you, buy your own, and then you carry them to that school, and when you finish you carry them back to wherever you want to carry them to. If we did that, if we were not waiting that until we have this church building, that church building, the church will have grown beyond where we are right now. It says he gathered them, those disciples, to that school of Tyrannus, and then it says, and this continued by the space of how many years? Tell me out loud. An apostle, Paul the Apostle, in his school apartment, his school building, for 2 years. And he wasn't concerned about that. He wasn't saying, well, I'm an apostle, how can I stay here for 2 years? I should be able to raise up money to build something. That wasn't the preoccupation at that time. The preoccupation was preach the gospel, and they were preaching the gospel. Look at this again, verse 10. And this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all they that dwelt in Asia had the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. In fact, this is the place where he was in that school that this great miracle took place, and God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs and aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirit also went out of them. It will happen again. I said it will happen again. And let's look at the word of God in chapter 16 of Acts. Acts chapter 16. And you remember they wanted to go to a particular place. The spirit said no. To another place, the spirit said no. Eventually they had this vision. And look at it in verse 9. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. And there stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over into Macedonia and help us. That's a Macedonian call. Come out to Macedonia and help us. And it's like we're receiving calls from different places now all over the world. I can remember that country and that country and that other country. They're sending to us and they say, come and establish the church here. And come, we're members of Deeper Life, we love Deeper Life, we have not found any teaching in any of the churches we have here. We want to send missionaries. And then suppose we just call you and we say, now we're sending you to this particular country. We say, well and good, but how many of the people do we have? We say we have this number of people there already, and they're ready to walk with you. Then you say, when I get there, how about, church building? I will say, well, at present now, we're even struggling here with that kind of a thing here. So then you want to send me out? Are we going to have church? Look at this now. Come over to Macedonia and help us. Look at it from verse 13. And on the Sabbath day, we went out of the city. What follows here? I mean, what have you reading? What are you reading here? Paul the Apostle, after a great revelation, after the vision, after the thing that the Lord told him by this great vision, come over to Macedonia and help us. And over there in Macedonia, we even hear of, him going to the synagogue or going to the temple of the Jews. But over here now, no synagogue. The people that were gathered there, not even in a house now. See where they were meeting. Verse 13, it says, we went out of the city by a riverside where prayer was wont to be made. And we sat down by a riverside and spake unto the women which resorted thither. You see, if we have the mind of the scriptures, and we have the might of the Lord, whether it's riverside, or football field, or backyard of somewhere, or a street corner, anywhere, any space we have chance to declare the word of God will not be seen. How can I, Paul the Apostle, and I leave all that behind, and here I am going to do this or that? That's the calling of the Lord. And I pray that we'll respond positively to the call of the Lord in Jesus' name. You know, we allow many things to hinder us that didn't hinder the Lord Jesus Christ. We allow many things to hinder us that didn't hinder the apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ. We allow many things to hinder us that did not hinder Paul the Apostle. He said, we're sorted there. Look at it in verse 14. A certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple, of the city of Thyatira, which worshipped God and heard us. It was by that riverside that this Lydia heard the gospel. And then it says, whose heart the Lord opened to the gospel. She became saved by that riverside. Then it says that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul, the doctrines of Paul the Apostle emphasized, the transformation of life, the change that ought to come, the new creature that came by the cleansing of the blood of the Lamb, and the turning around, and the transformation of life that Paul the Apostle spoke about. It happened to this woman when she attended to the things that Paul the Apostle spoke. And then he says, and when she was baptized, they had converts from that place, from that riverside that became baptized. She and her household, she besought us, saying, if ye have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into mine house and abide there. The apostle did not even have a place to sleep, a place to stay, and they've just been managing. And this woman that just gave her life to the Lord Jesus Christ then put pressure on them, come to my house, and she constrained us. That shows you then how they did the work in the New Testament, and that shows you how we're going to do the work today. And this work will prosper in our hands in Jesus' name. And all these complaints and excuses who have been given, I believe the scripture has swept everything away from our minds in Jesus' name. What are we going to have now? We're going to have churches in houses. Everybody say churches in houses. We're going to multiply them. Yes, when the cathedral comes, praise the Lord, there's something going on at Bagada. But you know, if you wait for that Bagada, until we have something like Bagada, we didn't start there, my brother. We didn't start there, my sister. We started in a house, then we moved to another church building that they just gave us, and then we used that and went from place to place, from place to place, and here we are now. By the grace of God, you will come to the place where you can build a great sanctuary like this in Jesus' name. But you start where you are. You start with the houses. You start with the schools. You start with the regional resource. You start with anywhere you can. And then you raise up thousands of members. After those thousands of members in the house churches, then if God gives us chance to have cathedrals, we are going to have them in Jesus' name. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 19, again, 1 Corinthians chapter 16, we're looking at verse 19. The churches of Asia salute you, Aquila and Priscilla salute you much in the Lord. Well, the church in their house. Well, the church in their house. There's a church, there was a church in their house, there'll be a church in your own house too. Colossians chapter 4. You understand what we're saying? Sometimes there are people that come and they say, well, we don't have any church building yet. Let us contribute money. I contribute 1,000 naira. My brother, what will 1,000 naira do in building a church? You know what you can do better? Yes, bring the 1,000 naira, but you see, you can also give your apartment, your house, and say, until we're able to get land and have our own church building, here is my house. You can give your workshop, where you have all that, all those gadgets, and then you have space over there. You use that for a particular hall. You can get a town hall. You can do a lot of things and give us an apartment here, an apartment here, so that we can have about 100 churches in one little city, 500 churches in one city, and in the mega churches, there be 1,000 churches over there, and we have 100 people there, 120 people there, 150 people there, 200 people there, and we're meeting, and we run into hundreds of thousands in that single city, because we have churches in their houses. I'm looking at Colossians chapter 4 verse 15. Colossians chapter 4 verse 15, salute the brethren which are in Laodicea and Nymphas, and the church which is in his house. The church which is in his house. They did it then, we're going to do it now. Philemon, I'm looking at verses 1 and 2 again. Philemon, verses 1 and 2. Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy, a brother, unto Philemon, our dearly beloved and fellow laborer, and our beloved Apphia and Archippus, a fellow soldier, and to the church in thy house. To the church in thy house. In your house, you have a place that can take 50 people. Tell your pastor, can I have a church there? Your house, you have a place that can take 100 people. Tell your pastor, can I have a church there? You have a hall, you have an apartment that can take about maybe 200 people in the sitting room or whatever. Tell your pastor, we want to multiply the churches. Before we come next time, house churches will grow and multiply in deeper life in Jesus' name. And all the various countries, we're going to have thousands and thousands and thousands of house churches. And if you just have 100 members in that house fellowship, if you have 1,000 such churches in one country, and you have 100 here, 100 here, 100 there, 100 times 1,000 is going to be how many? 100,000. And if you have 10 countries having something like that, you're going to have 1,000,000. And all this waiting and waiting and waiting for this and for that, we're not waiting for anything anymore. We have Jesus, we have the Holy Spirit, we have the Almighty God, we have the gospel, we have the doctrine, we have the minister, we have the power to pray, and we have all these provisions, and then we have your house, we've got a church. I said we've got a church. What else do we need? God, Christ, Holy Spirit, Bible, doctrine, the minister, and the house. A church is available already. And you are available. Are you available? And your house is available. Are they available? Rise up and tell the Lord. We're available. We're available. We're available. On the other side at the DLCC now, the person moderating today will take over, and you lead our people to a prayer of commitment for about 10 minutes. That's what we're doing here. Lead the people right now so that what we have, we give to the Lord, and then we're going to have thousands of churches in each country. Pastor Chike, please take over. You tell the Lord. Our brother is going to lead us now. Let us really pray. Pray of commitment and consecration. I will surrender what we have. We're going to have thousands of churches in every country.
Brethren, we have heard about the word of God.